Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we just thank you as we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. Thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives, because quite frankly, Father, we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man or a woman. We haven't come to hear from an old man, a young man, tall man, short man. We haven't come to hear from black man, white man, brown man, or woman of any kind. We've come to hear from the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us. Direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. Thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives this night, that we walk out of this place, every one of us, Lord, walk out of this place different than when we came in, and God will give you the praise as you bless us, and we'll bless those around us. And Father, we thank you that you bless every church in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and our sisters, and at no time do we think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves co-laborers, workers together, one field, building one kingdom. You know what that is? Yours, not man's. And God will give you the praise, give you the glory, give you the honor, in Jesus' mighty name. With a great big shout, we say amen. I've been thinking a lot about life lately. I don't know, I always do and always have. There was something that took place when I first got saved. I was in my late 20s. And as I got saved, I'm probably a lot like some of you that are in this room right now. I didn't know anything about God. I mean, I had no clue whatsoever. The denominational church that I went to taught me zero. I had no idea about anything. I mean, I had no concept of prophets. I had no concept of Jesus. If someone said, well, you have the sanctification by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, I would have thought he was an idiot talking to me about something I have no clue about. I never heard those words in my life. Had no idea about anything. I just simply got to a place in my relationship with life that I needed God, and I knew it, and I gave simply my heart to God, and something happened all those years ago. And what had happened in my life was that something opened a door in my heart, and that's something the Holy Spirit came in. And from that moment on, I desired more than anything, and still do to this day, to do something to make God big in the eyes of other people. Sounds weird, doesn't it? A lot of people want to make God big in their eyes or big in someone else's eyes, but I just wanted to make God big in the eyes of other people. I had no idea what that meant. You know, I'd put a bumper sticker on my car, one on the other side in those days. I had a license plate that had scripture on it. Drove it around with bumper stickers. Didn't matter where it was. If my business had an advertisement, it had a fish on it or had something on it. I just wanted to do something to tell somebody about the goodness of God. Had no claim, had to no understanding of the things that I was doing and why I felt like I did. When I heard somebody else lifting up the name of Jesus, it excited me. When I heard about somebody else singing a song about Jesus, it excited me. When someone wrote lyrics about Jesus, it excited me because Jesus was being lifted up. My life somehow went from lifting myself up to lifting up God in the eyes of other people. One day I was in church and God spoke to me and said, "You're really tall and you're on the front row." And I said, "Yeah," because I've always been tall and I always felt like everybody behind me can't see. I don't know how many times I've gone into a movie theater, sat down, everybody behind me vacates the seats and goes sit somewhere else. After a while, that really gets to you, you know? And Debbie always wants to sit in the middle, and I want to sit off to the edge somewhere and where people aren't sitting behind me. But I remember being in church, and I was on the front row, and God said, "I want these people that are looking at you to see you lifting me up. And I raised my hands to God. First time I ever raised my hands to God, I felt like a fool. But I knew it was right. And all of a sudden, it just was inside me that my life was meant to do something. And that was to lift up who God is. Not to lift up who I was. Not to lift up human understanding or nature. But to lift up who God is and make him big so that people could see him as he really is. Title of the message is Glorifying God with Our Lives. Bottom line, for every one of us in here, that's where we're at. We live our life to glorify God, and when you do, all of a sudden, God starts to bless you. The problem with this is that a lot of people don't understand what the word glorifying means. Now, I've told you, and I'm gonna tell you, years and years ago, we went into the depth of understanding the word glory. But tonight, I wanna just rehearse that a little bit. Some of you are thinking, because there's so many new people, you don't understand what the word glory means. Sometimes when we say, let's glorify God, it really, we say, well, we'll make God luminous. We'll make, you know, God does something. We'll make God, see, the truth be known is we don't make God anything. He's already as big as he could possibly be. But there's a desire to do something, and that's to demonstrate how great and wonderful God is. To understand the word glory, if I'm going to with my life and you're going to with your life, bring a life of glory to God, to your family, to your children. This is called being a witness to your bosses, to the people in your neighborhood, to the people around you, to the, wherever you go. If you're going to be that witness that God is calling, that you really deep down inside want to be, you're gonna have to do something. You don't show how smart you are in God or about God. You show how big God is. You talk about him, not you. You talk about not what you know, but what he does. And all of a sudden, the glory of God is demonstrated to people. To understand the word glory, we have to go all the way back to the beginning. Exodus, the 33rd chapter, when you'll find Moses talking to God and God talking to Moses. May I tell you about the story? Go there with me in Exodus, the 33rd chapter. We find, if you look at the first few verses, here's God speaking to Moses saying, I want you to take these people that I brought out of Egypt, and I want you to take them to the promised land. They're a stiff-necked people, but I want you to take them into the promised land, the land that I promised their fathers, because God wanted to keep his word. And he's, you know, the promised land, you know, it's filled with milk and honey and tremendous wealth and abundance and blessing. They didn't have to do anything. All they had to do was go and trust God. Did you know that same promised land's waiting for you? All you have to do is go and trust God. You don't have to build it. You don't have to do anything about it. God will open the doors for it. God will make a way for it. The promised land that God has for you is just ahead of you as long as you're willing to go and believe, trust God. And that was the only requirement they had. But Moses was carrying on this conversation with God. He makes a statement, 33rd chapter. He says, God, I'll take them, but I'm not going with them unless you go with us. I need your presence, because without your presence, God, you might as well forget it. Because I'm not going, just leave us here. And I just say one thing about that kind of a statement. Listen closely. He was smart enough to know that even though God said, go, the promised land is yours, all you have to do is trust me. He was smart enough to know that whatever you're going to do and wherever you're going to do it, you better have God with you. And God speaks to him and he makes a statement about going with him in his presence. And I'll start in verse number 17. It's really fascinating. Remember, we're talking about the word glory. Because if I'm going to, with my life, glorify God, I need to know what in the heck that means. I need to know how to do it. I don't want some preacher to stand in front of me and tell me, here's what you do to glorify God, and not tell me and show me how to do it. I want to know what it means and how to do Because I want to live my life making God big to a lost and dying world. Why? Because they need to know there really is a Superman on the planet, and he's not in a red and blue tight outfit. His name is Jesus. Is anybody listening? And so with that in mind, verse number 17 of the 33rd chapter of Exodus, so the Lord said to Moses. Now, as I read through these verses, I'm going to tell you who's saying and who's talking to who. We'll look at it together. Is that okay? So here's God in 17th chapter talking to Moses. And he makes this statement. So the Lord said to Moses, I will also do this thing. Remember, he asked him to come with me. I want your presence. I need your presence. That you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name. Verse 18. Verse 18 comes along and he said, please then show me your glory. So all of a sudden we see this word glory, and it's God's glory that he's identified, and he wants something. He said, listen, I want your presence, but I want to know what your glory is. That ought to be the cry of every Christian, because if you're ever going to do anything with God or with your life or have any kind of direction in your life, you ought to know what in the heck you're supposed to be doing. So Moses is smart enough to ask God something. He says, show me your glory. That ought to be the cry of every one of us. God, here's my day. It's Monday. I'm going out to work. I want to see your glory at work in my life. Show me your glory. And in verse number 19, he makes a statement. And now he, notice a capital H in the word he, speaking, God said back to Moses. Now, he said, I will make, notice all the capitalizations in here. I will make my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. This is the first part of this 19th verse. He says, I will make my goodness pass before you. Wait a minute, that doesn't mean anything. He asked to see the glory. Show me your glory in verse 18. Verse 19, God responds, and God responds by saying something very interesting. I will make my goodness pass before you. Last part of that verse, if you will. He says, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I also have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Verse number 20 comes along, and he says, but he said, you cannot see my face. No man should see my face and live. Verse 21. And the Lord said, here is a place by me, and you shall stand on the rock. Now remember, keep in mind, he's asked, show me your glory. God responds, I'll make my goodness pass before you. Verse number 22 gets interesting. So it shall be that while my glory passes by, wait a minute. While my glory passes by, not, he said, I'll make my goodness pass by. He says, but I'm going to want you to, Moses says, I want you to show me your glory. He said, I'll make my goodness passed by, and then God speaks here, and he says, my, notice the capital M in the word glory, my glory passed by. So glory and goodness are synonymous with each other, which a lot of people don't understand. I don't see the illumination of God when I glorify God, but what I see about God is his goodness in my life. And his goodness is synonymous with his glory. They're one and the same. And he goes on and he makes this statement. Remember, let's go back to verse, if I could, John. Could I just have you go back to verse number, I think it was 19, for a second. He says, and I'll make my goodness pass before you. Now, was God lying? No. Verse, if you will, go back to the last verse. Verse, and I will make my goodness pass before you, verse 22, while my glory passes by. So God's goodness is his glory, and when it is seen, it's called manifested goodness. And manifested goodness is the glory of God. So if I'm going to glorify God, I'm going to glorify God by lifting up His goodness and what He's done. Not in me, just in me, but His goodness and what He has done, what He's going to do, whatever He is part of. And so when I lift up the word, let me put this up, John, the glory of God is His manifested goodness. Good. The glory of God is His manifested. The word manifested means seen. It's an interesting word, manifest. It means to be recognized or displayed. When the seen, recognized, display, goodness of God is seen, that's His glory. When we go out in the streets and take care of the people, man, that's His glory. When we feed the poor, that's His glory. When He come into the house of God and He heals the people, His goodness comes in the place and He heals the people. Why? Because it's His glory that's in the house of God. Follow me? So when I give you a title of a message, glorifying God, go back to the title, would you, John? Glorifying God with our lives. Now we understand that glorifying God is simply bringing forth His manifested goodness publicly. So when I was a young man, all I wanted to do was lift God up. What God was saying is, I want you to glorify me by displaying my goodness to a lost, dying world. Same with every single one of us. And when you read the word glory, if you put in there, say, glory, you put manifested goodness in there, it fits all the way through the entire Bible. It's really cool. So here's the question. How to glorify God with my life? Five quick things. And what I did is I found five things that describe bringing glory to God that I can do. I found it in the Word of God. You know, we can make a lot of statements about I do this, I do that, I do this, I do that. But I want to find out what the Word said. Five things the Word of God says that I can do to bring the manifested goodness to a lost, dying world, or even to a congregation, because there's always people in our congregation that are not right with God that need to get right with God. Is everybody listening? Five things on how to glorify God with my life. Number one, by total consecration. I gotta be honest with you, when I say this, I don't know of any other way but total consecration. I don't see where anybody that's half in and half out gets anywhere. In fact, if you're half in and half out, you're not gonna make it. And that's the shocking part. Now, I'm not telling you who's going to make it and who isn't, because I'm not God, nor am I the judge. But, you know, in what I read in the Scriptures after all these 50 years of reading in the Scriptures, I'm here to tell you something. I really believe it with all of my heart, man. There's no such thing as half in, half out. If you're on both sides of the fence, you're in trouble. And the only thing that's going to bring glory to God, the only way God can ever use you as an instrument, is if there's total consecration to the things of God. That means I'm totally committed. I'm totally in. It's all of it and all in 100%. I'm not going anywhere else. I'm living, breathing, walking, man. The Holy Ghost is on the inside of me. I may not know what I'm doing. I don't know how it works. I may not even know what the word glory means. I don't know how it happens. I don't know how to express it. I don't know how God heals. I don't know very much at all. But one thing I have, and that's a very simple thing, I'm totally committed to the things of God. And that's what I mean by total consecration. And without that, I don't even think you have a church. Because we can gather together with a guitar and sing Kumbaya until heavens turn blue and ain't gonna get anywhere. You can have the sweetest little gathering in the world. You might as well be at a ballpark listening to the things of God, the ball game, instead of the things of God. Because this is all about, listen to me, my friends, this is all about, and this number one thing is a total commitment. Someone says, well, that's radical. You better believe it. It was so radical with the disciples that every one of them lost their lives. Willingly, Paul says, man, crucify me where? Upside down, not worthy. Or was that Peter? Peter. My goodness sakes alive, Paul loses his head. I mean, every single one of them died. I mean, if there's not anything else that cries out, it's the blood of the martyrs and the blood of the apostles. They believed so much of what they were saying. and what they had seen and what they'd experienced, it cost them their lives, and willingly they gave it up. That means total consecration. My friends, we have a lukewarm church in America where people get together and it's a thing to do. It's a friendly activity. You meet your friends, you gather together. It's a social hour on Sunday morning. You hear a Reader's Digest suggestion. Nobody ever bothers the church. They tell you about things that don't bug you and don't, and listen, can I say something? In order to keep you in church, why do they want to keep you in church? Because you bring money. And somebody needs to stand up and say it like it is. It's going to take total, complete consecration to the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, like we've said every single week in this place, you're either hot or cold, but don't give me that lukewarm stuff, because you're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. And he's going to come and say, I know you not. Go from you, worker of iniquity. Wait a minute. And he says, Lord, I don't understand. What do you mean, Lord, Lord? I cast out devils in your name. I would think somebody who cast out devils in the name of Jesus had some idea of who Jesus was. Yet Jesus looks at him and says, go from me, you worker of iniquity. I know you not. Wait a minute, we prophesied in your name. I would think, wouldn't you, that somebody who prophesies in the name of Jesus has some concept of who Jesus is. Jesus looks at the guy who prophesied in the name of Jesus, says, go from your work of iniquity, I know you not. Oh my goodness sakes alive, my friends. This is a very serious time of wholehearted commitment to Jesus. Soon the eastern sky is going to split and Jesus is coming for us, and we need to be ready. Come on, somebody. And somebody needs to love us enough to stop playing church and throwing incense and perfumes all over us and lighting candles and tell us the truth about Jesus. Not picking on any group of people, but if you're in that category, you better wake up. Not that you're listening to me by any means. 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, verse 20 says it like this. For you were bought with a price. Somebody say amen. Amen. You know what that price is? It's Jesus. Therefore, glorify God where? In your body and in your spirit, which is God's. In other words, you're going to have to display the manifested goodness of God in every area, in every realm, physically and spiritually in your life. Total consecration. Number two, we're talking about how to glorify God with my life. Number two, by verbal and physical expression, which quite frankly is praise in the scripture. By verbal and physical expression. A lot of times we don't realize that that in itself is a praise to God. It doesn't have to be to a song. It doesn't have to be to a beat. It doesn't have to be to music. Just the way that I live my life is an expression physically, and the what comes out of my mouth is expression verbally that brings praise to God. When somebody brings praise to God, it's not just a song beat, my friends. The greatest praise you will ever bring to God is your life committed to Him, serving Him, and displaying His goodness through your life to a lost and dying world. And that's what I'm talking about. In Psalms 22, verse 23, it says this, you who fear the Lord. Boy, that's a great sentence. We could go 2 weeks on that one. And it says, praise Him, all you descendants of Jacob. Glorify Him. There's a glorifying coming in. And fear Him, all you offsprings of Israel. So He makes it very clear for every single one of us, with our mouth and with our life, we praise God and we demonstrate the goodness of God to the people that are lost and dying around us by how we live and how we act and what we do and what we don't do. Your mouth and your word. Has anybody ever had body language? All of us have. Your body language tells us exactly what your mouth is not saying. And your mouth is telling us different than your body language. And all of which has got to be brought together to glorify God, to bring forth His goodness to a lost and dying world that's waiting for the truth as we glorify God with our lives. Third thing, on how to glorify God with my life and your life. By doing godly things. There's a lot of things you could do. But I'm talking about doing godly things. The whole world out there is full of do-gooders. Not one time does it ever display the goodness of God until you and I do what was godly and good. And there's a difference between somebody who does something good, it's recognized by the world, that never brings any glory, remember, manifested goodness to God, than somebody who does what God would have him to do, and that brings the glory to God. Very important for us in Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 16 said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see the good works." What kind of good works is he talking about? It's got to be godly activity. Godly ways of doing things, godly ways of speaking, godly ways of taking care of the poor, godly ways of surrendering and sacrificing yourself for the betterment of someone else's, which is love. And it's God that works. Godly good works is not just good works, because everybody's got a definition of good works, but none good but God. That's God works. He said, let them see your God activities, your God works, and glorify your Father in heaven. When people see you doing what God would have you do, it shows off his, you become now a show off for God. And that's what this church is all about since day one. We're here to show off the goodness of God. And we do it with missions, and we do it with feeding the poor, and we do it with hospitals, and we do it with the convalescent hospitals, and we do it with the prisons, and we do it under the bridges, and we do it with back to school bashes, giving kids that don't even go to our school what they need. And all of these things, you say, why do you do those things? They cost lots of money. We do them because it brings glory to God. That's why we do it. You need to know that. We could gather together, never take up an offering, and just sing songs to God and miss God completely. We take up an offering because we're going to do something with it. We're going to go out the streets and go into the hospitals and under the bridges and meet the needs of people and feed 500,000 people more. I don't know about you, but I want to get more buses and go after more people. So, oh, I tell you something. I remember when we started our bus ministry, a really nice, sophisticated couple came to me and said, we're leaving the church. And I said, why are you leaving? Man, they were like the only givers in the church at that time. And I'll never forget the words that they said. We just don't like the people you're bringing into church. It's all about poor people. And they left the church. You know, they were gone for about 4 or 5 years and realized they were wrong and came back. Both of them are in heaven today. We've buried them both. They're both in heaven today. And they served the poor all the days of their life. Why? Because it's called glorifying God. And that's what we specialize in at the Rock Church World Outreach Center. A lot of people call you names. A lot of people jealous. A lot of people say ugly things about the Rock. But I want you to know something. I don't care what they say. I only know what God says. And God likes this place. You know how I know he likes it? Hey, you know how I know? His presence is here to heal and to save. Come on, somebody. You say anything you want to say. I want to know something. If I'm going to live a glorified life for God, how do I glorify God with my life? Number four, by bearing godly fruit. You can bear all kinds of fruit. Godly fruit is different than just good fruit. A lot of people will say they're bear good fruit. That most people don't know what good is. None good but God, so therefore it's got to be bearing godly fruit. It's just like the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, temperance, meekness. Word temperance is an interesting word, isn't it? Most people translate the word temperance as self-control. Did you know that's not what temperance is really is, self-control? I never want to be in control of myself. I want to be Holy Spirit controlled. Are you following me? So someone who takes the word of God and makes it good, if you will, in this particular case, bearing good fruit, is not what I'm saying. Because I don't give a flip about what the world calls good. I want to see a church gather together to glorify God, to bear godly fruit. When we do what His goodness says that we should be doing and operating on, it displays His goodness. And guess what? He's present in it. And in His presence, there's healing power. And His presence is what you need. Come on, my friends. This is good news. By bearing godly fruit. Anybody can bear fruit. Godly fruit is different. And that means we're going to have to make sure that it's outlined by the things of the Lord and the word of God. John 15, verse number 8 says this, "By this my Father is glorified." By what? By what? "That you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples," Jesus says. Very important for us. And the only way you and I are ever going to bear godly fruit is if we are into the vine. And we are attached to Him. It says, live, stay, dwell, and abide in Him. That's what Pastor Dan was talking about this morning. It's a rough thing to live, stay, dwell, abide in Him. Sometimes you don't ever see Him move on your behalf. Ever wondered why that is? Sometimes it doesn't come through as fast as you think. Sometimes somebody tells you something and never comes to pass. Sometimes you get discouraged because your prayers don't go any further than the ceiling and they're not answered. It's during those times that you hang in there and are consistent with your consecration of the things of God that prove you're not going anywhere, and it won't be long before in His timing what you asked Him for will come to pass. Come on, somebody. It's true. So you may not get the answers to what you, I want them right now. Don't we want everything right now? Man, you can't even go, there used to be a time when you drove up to a taco stand and if you didn't get all of your meal in 30 seconds, you got your money back. Does anybody remember that? And you sat there and you timed it just to make sure that you're gonna get your money back. God is not a fast food taco stand. But we want that with God. We're gonna have to understand, listen, whatever it takes, God, you're in control. All things work together for the good of them. Love the Lord, call according to His purpose. Therefore, it doesn't matter how long it takes. I'm going to stand and keep on standing until I know it's going to come to pass. Without that, my friends, we don't bear very good fruit. Last one, number 5. How am I going to glorify God with my life? By spiritual unity. Spiritual unity, if there's anything that you've ever seen at the Rock Church is spiritual unity. We don't hang around with every church. We can't. There's too many. We don't invite you to their men's conference or women's conference. Why? Because we have our own. And we know you only have a certain amount of time. And if we had a choice between you being there or here, we want you at your church. That's just honest with you. And I want you to know something. We believe that what we're doing is as good or if not better than anybody else. Why should we send you somewhere else? So what we do is we pray for them, we love them, we encourage them. Pastor spends time with other pastors encouraging them to go forward in the things of God on a constant basis, telling them, listen, don't stop. Did you know 15,000 pastors quit the ministry every single month because of discouragement? 15,000 in America quit every month because of discouragement. This is a hard, hard job. We're there encouraging them. We're there loving them. We believe in unity, oneness. And it's not a big I and a little you. This is not the way it works. We're all in this together. And that's why, you know, for most of you, that's the first time when you came to this church that you ever heard another pastor pray for other churches and other denominations. And you know it. And you go back to the churches where you came from and see if they lift up the rock. I'm not picking on them, but we refuse to do anything but tell you we're in this together to do one thing, to build the kingdom of God. And that's called unity. And where there's unity, there's God, and God gets glorified because in unity is glorification or the manifestation of God's goodness. Romans, the 15th chapter, verse 6 says this, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify. One mind and one mouth glorify. One mind and one mouth glorify. One mind and one mouth. He's talking about us being that close that we're all on the same page. We're not better, we're all on the same page. Different sizes, different ways, different styles. That's okay. It needs to have their own style. If they want to do their own thing a certain way, that's their business, not my business. My business is to do what God tells us to do here. But my business is not to criticize them or pick on them. My business is to say, hey, listen, here's how this works. Unity is very important. Because without unity, there's not going to be a glorification of God. With one mind and one mouth, glorifying God the Father, Lord Jesus Christ. Glorifying God the Father, Lord Jesus Christ. We need to realize that we need each other. And, you know, sometimes you wonder, you say, well, how come there's so many churches? And how come they're so different? And how come they specialize in this or they emphasize that? And how come they emphasize this and emphasize that? Can I tell you something? That's not my problem, neither is it yours. Who are we, the Bible says in the 14th chapter of Romans, and verse, I believe it's 4. Who are we to judge another man's servant? To his master he'll fall or stand, and his master will make him stand. Doesn't matter how they do church. They have to do it their way. Our way is different, but that doesn't make them not valuable to God. Because God hadn't shut them down. And God's there as he is here. And unity is very important. Come on, somebody. Five things. Total consecration. By verbal and physical expressions, which is called praise. Your lifestyle, what you express. By doing godly things. By bearing, number 4, godly fruit. And number 5, by spiritual unity, we glorify God. If God spoke to you, come on tonight, give him a great big praise. Will you do that? Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? If you haven't given God all of your heart, you got to give it to him. He's not a thief to rob it from you. If you haven't given him your heart and you haven't made that total consecration of all of your heart and all of your life, somebody needs to tell you you're not saved. You're really a nice person. There's a little boy right here. Can somebody help me right here? There's no way you're gonna get my attention. Listen to me if there's a little boy running around. Is he cute? He wants to get saved. There's Papa. And you need to give God all of your heart. You need to give God all of your life. Today, God brought you here as a divine appointment. You haven't really given God all of it. You know who God is in your head. You celebrate Christmas and Easter, and you've even called yourself a Christian. But knowing him in your head will not get you to heaven. It's about what you've done with your heart. Have you given him all of your heart? Have you given him all of your life? Listen, the words of Jesus is this. No man goes to the Father except by me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he comes along and he makes this statement. You must be born again. Why leave this place without giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life? Everything starts with a wholehearted commitment to Jesus. So you know him in your head, but you haven't yet given him your heart and life. He won't steal it. He won't make it happen. He's not a thief or a conniver to talk you out of it. It's your heart and life he's after. And that's what it's going to take. You have to make the choice to give God all of your heart, to be born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. And tonight, here you are in this safe, friendly place. There's 15 of you need to get out of your seat right now, just like you did earlier, some of you. Get out of your seat, bring your coat, purse, sweater, Bible. I won't embarrass you. Get out of your seat, stand up, walk down the aisle, meet me right here. And then we're going to let the rest of you go. But there's 15 of you. Now, I don't know if anybody will come. But I'm going to give you an opportunity right now. Get up out of your seat. Get your stuff. Get down the aisle. Right now, you come. Just stand up. You know you're smart enough to give God all of your heart. You're smart enough to give God all of your life. Who'll start this? Just get up and come right now. Come on. Anybody? Anybody? Here's one. Thank you. Who else? There's 15 of you. There's 14 more of you that need to come right now. Just start walking towards me and I'll count you as you come. Just come stand right here. Can I have an usher here, please? There's two more or three more or one more? Two more. There's 12 of you now that need to come. You know you're not saved. You know you're not right with God. These people have some guts that'll come and do what they need to do. Let me tell you something. One of the very first thing God says are people who will go to hell. Do you know who they are? Cowards. First word, not sinners, cowards. You're afraid of what people will think of you and afraid what the world says. You need to get out of your seat and you need to come. You need to come. Tonight is your night of salvation. Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on. Come on. Jesus says, if you confess me before men, that's why you've got to come down here. I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. And you know you need to come and you're not coming. You're making a statement with your body language that says, no, I'm denying Jesus, when you know you need to come. Get out of your seat. Get down. Come on. Come on, just come. I'll count you. There's three more. There's nine more of you that need to come. Nine more of you that need to come. Nine more of you. Now, I don't know if you'll come, but you need to stand and come. Check with your neighbor. Say, come on, I'll go with you. There's nine more of you. There's eight more of you. There's seven more of you. There's six more of you. Wait a minute, don't clap. I'm fishing right now. And my pond shake, you throw rocks in my pond. There's six more of you. You guys come stand right here. There's a move of the Holy Spirit in this house right now, right before your eyes. God is drawing people home. No hype, no foolishness. Just drawing people home. Just get out of your seat and come. How many more are there? Does anybody remember? Six more of you? Or is there five more of you? Three more, someone says. Now, he's an usher. He gets saved every week. I think there's like five more of you. Anybody else? It's your call. You saw it yourself. All they need to do is get up and come. All you need to do is get up and come. Anybody else? All you need to do, stand up and walk. You do it every day. Walk for life. You say, Pastor, I can't do that. I'll be embarrassed. When you get in hell, then you'll really be embarrassed. And you'd stand up and run anywhere to get out of hell. No clap. How many are there of you? There's how many? Four of you? Four? I know, but how many are coming? Four of you. Come on up here. Here's number five right here. There's six and seven more. That's more than 15. I think you just saw God right before your eyes. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Amazing. Now look. Okay, yeah, SPTs, come on. This is Reverend Antonio. Reverend Antonio is a cool guy. No weird stuff goes on. He's going to give you some stuff, but he's going to pray with you, give you some free stuff, tell you about a program we have that'll help you, called Spiritual Personal Trainers, so you don't have to go back serving the devil, but you can go on with God. Is that okay? We love you a lot. I need some SPTs. If you're an SPT, get up here. And so this is cool. All you guys, follow Antonio right over there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer, of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.